Plastic pollution is more than bags and bottles and things we can see. A good deal of plastic pollution exists in things we can't see. They're called microplastics, and new scientific research is underway to find out what impact they might have on humans and the environment. This coming week, PBS NewsHour is launching the series The Plastic Problem, a deep dive into the dangers of plastics and possible solutions to the problems they present. I spoke recently with Andrea Thompson, Associate Editor for Sustainability at Scientific American, about her series on microplastics. Andrea Thompson, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
We've heard these stories about whales beaching up on shore with 17 pounds of plastic in their belly, and we've heard about the damage that plastic does in the oceans, but you're focusing on something much more interesting, which is microplastics on a very, very small scale. Tell us, first of all, what is a microplastic and why is it dangerous?
So microplastics, they cover a huge range of sizes, which is one of the things that makes them so worrisome. You know, they are 5 millimeters down to, you know, maybe the size of a virus. So that's a huge, huge scale. And that small scale means that they can be ingested by a wide range of animals, from tiny plankton, which are the basis of the ocean food chain, to even whales, to us. They're the fragments of the plastic debris we see around us, bottles, bags, things like that, that gets broken down in the environment by sunlight, waves, wind, as well as fibers coming off of our clothes. They're called microfibers. And some of the products, microbeads that are in things like toothpaste, cosmetics.
Those exfoliant creams and so forth that have that little gritty feel.
Yeah.
So what are the effects that it could have upstream? So say, for example, you're eating a fish that came from the ocean that has microplastics in it. You might not see a chunk of plastic in the flesh, but it might actually be in the system and you're consuming it.
That's one of the biggest areas of scientific research right now, is what that might actually be doing to us and our system. A lot of it depends on how much of it we're actually ingesting every day. There's possibilities that, you know, if it's small enough, it could penetrate the gut lining and get into other systems. It can cause inflammation, which can lead to other health problems.
You also took a look at plastics in soil. How does it get there? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not just the stuff that we're leaving in the landfill.
Right. There are a couple or several ways it can get there. One, and I think it's one that, you know, people aren't really familiar with, is that the things that are cleared out of wastewater and wastewater treatment plants, it makes this sludge that gets treated and then is often applied to agricultural fields because it's very rich in nutrients. But it also happens to be very rich in microplastics, particularly microfibers from, you know, the testing that's been done so far. And so scientists right now are trying to figure out, okay, as we're plowing soil and other things, how deep is that microfiber getting into the soil? Is it washing back into waterways? Is it impacting the health of the soil that we're growing our food in, and therefore, you know, how the ability to grow crops and things like that? They have shown that earthworms can eat these, and that could travel up the food chain as those creatures get eaten by other ones.
As we look at the scale of this problem, this is part of a series of stories that you're writing, but what are the solutions here? How do we even start to tackle this?
Most of the scientists I talk to are okay, if not, you know, full supporters of a lot of these bans that are being done against plastic bags, straws, because they consider those the low-hanging fruit, the easy things to do. We don't need those things. But there are also the plastics, things that we need to use plastic for, but we're not considering when we make these and design these things, what happens to them when we're done with them. And so that needs to start being incorporated into the design process and how we make plastics. So there are scientists doing work to actually try and make plastics that can be recycled more easily over and over again, like glass can, for instance. And to try and, you know, close some of those loops in our waste system where it's escaping out into the environment. So it's a whole bunch of different things that will have to be done, and us really facing that we need to kind of reevaluate our relationship with plastic.
All right. Andrea Thompson, Associate Editor for Sustainability at Scientific American. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.